So when of the energy is negative, that is why energy density can be constant, and when under the exhibition, expansion, you said that the law of conservation energy will hold. But some of the astronauts will say that there is an interstellar material which releases the energy, and it becomes a star and starts to emit light eventually. So if the energy is minus and if the interstellar material is solidified, then star will be cooled so that it might not be able to release light. So how do you explain that about the expulsion? So first question, would you like to answer, did you get it?
The question, like I said, is asking whether or not this cancellation between positive energy of matter and negative energy of gravity would work if the matter starts doing complicated things like forming stars and so on. And I think the answer is that conservation of energy is a principle which is simply golden as far as physicists know, as far as we know all the laws of physics impose conservation of energy. So as long as conservation of energy works during the inflationary process itself, which it does, and there it is, just a simple cancellation between two forms of energy, the positive energy in the form of the repulsive gravity material and negative energy in the form of the gravitational field, as long as energy is conserved through that process, which it has to be, if it's described right, then whatever happens after will also conserve energy. And the energy will continue to be whatever it's going to have to be, and that could be zero for all that we know.
So please go to the second question. I have a second question. So prior to and after inflation, the repulsion power is the same? And you have mentioned that the dark energy is still expanding, but when it comes to inflation, there is starting time of inflation. What is the strength of the repulsion before and after the inflation? And also under the multiverse, do you think the same old physics law would hold or not?
Questions there from writer. One was how does the strength of gravitational repulsion compare between inflation and the gentle acceleration that we see today, the fact that today we see the universe accelerate. And the answer is that they're vastly different. One can talk about the doubling time. The doubling time during inflation was something like 10 to the minus 38 seconds, perhaps. We're very uncertain about that number because it depends on the energy scale of inflation, which we don't really know. But a typical number for early universe inflation would be 10 to the minus 38 seconds for the doubling time, while the doubling time of the current acceleration of the universe is more like 10 billion years. It's a lot longer than 10 to the minus 38 seconds. So the acceleration today is vastly slower than the acceleration that we're proposing for the early universe. Then, I think, secondly, you asked, would the laws of physics be different in the different pocket universes of the multiverse, which is also a very important question. The answer that we are theorizing is that the ultimate laws of physics should be the same everywhere. We really don't have enough imagination to think about anything else. So, if the laws of physics are different in any other places, we have no way of knowing about those places, so we don't try to talk about them, but heaven or whatever. So, the ultimate laws of physics we think of being the same, but if the ultimate laws of physics are as complicated as string theory, even if it's not string theory, if they're as complicated as string theory, then there's more than one kind of vacuum, more than one kind of a stable state that you've been living in that could look like the vacuum around you. And each type of vacuum would carry with it its own behavior, even though the ultimate laws of physics would be the same. So, maybe an analogy would be that even though the laws of physics are the same, we might imagine ourselves living in air or living in water or living in liquid nitrogen, and the world around us would look very different in those cases, even though the laws of physics would be the same. And that's the situation with the multiverse. So there are perhaps 10 to the 500 different kinds of vacuum, and each of which would seem very different to the people living in them, if anybody did live in them, but the ultimate laws of physics would be the same.
So, Professor Ibbotson has that question. So, is the battle between the Lorientz of the Capri France?
Thank you. I have just a very simple question. Do I understand correctly that when the heat is empty balance to zero, as the universe expands, new matter is created?
Yes. During inflation, as the universe expands, the density of matter remains constant. And that means new matter is being created, yes.
In this present phase, is matter created right now, and it's called the heat equation of matter? Yes, by experiments.
Okay, you're in the present phase of accelerated expansion. The answer is yes, matter is being created, we think. Yes, we see it, not exactly. The new matter that's created is just the new dark energy that fills the ever-emerging region. So if the dark energy is really there, it's increasing in its volume, and therefore it's increasing in its amount. But we don't directly observe the dark energy.
There's no matter, per se.
There's no ordinary matter, that's right. The new stuff that's being created as the universe undergoes the exponential expansion caused by the dark energy is just more dark energy.
Thank you.
The lady who is seated at the court from the front. Well, Mr. Duke, I knew you by photo, so it's a great privilege for me to see you in person today. Thank you very much for your wonderful lecture today. Well, Lightbird, Mr. Hadley, maybe the inflation theory will hold even though discovery is made by the Lightbird, because there are some other studies that are going on. Sorry, I'm a total layman, but I have no imagination. But what is other parallel researches which are underway apart from the Lightbird, which is a Japan-centered research or workshop?
Okay, the question is, what research projects are underway to continue the test of inflation other than Lightbird? The answer, I guess, is that there's a lot of them, certainly on a shorter timescale than the Lightbird. The BATSET 2 team is continuing their studies, and they now have a new detector called the Kekker-A, and they're continuing to use both the Kekker-A and the original BATSET 2, which actually has been upgraded to what they now call BATSET 3. There's also something called the South Pole Telescope. There's also an experiment called SPIDER, which was a balloon-based experiment, was and is. They have data currently from a flight of their balloon, but they have not yet released, and I think they're also attending further flights. So there are really a great many experiments underway, and there are also other types of experiments. Like, for example, experiments that aim at looking at the hydrogen recombination line throughout the universe, which can provide more three-dimensional data of what the sky looks like. CMB is really only two-dimensional. So research is actually happening very quickly. And as I mentioned, there's a new result to be announced even tomorrow on a limit for the value of little r, the strength of gravitational waves of the early universe. So it's been leading to very exciting times, and they will continue to be very exciting.
I think that's one of the different ones. The Lightbird would not see a signal all the way down to the 0.01.
Is that a question?
What would it mean for inflation?
Okay, I'll try again. The one... one of the thorny issues really concerning these deficit gravity waves is that we really don't know what the prediction is. Inflation right now is still a whole class of models which make a broad range of predictions for the gravitational wave intensity. So if it's not seen at the level of Lightbird, at the level of 1001, there's still many inflationary models that would be perfectly viable, that would be consistent with that. From what I understand, experimentalists think that ultimately we might be able to get to 0.0001, another factor of 10. And beyond that, I don't think anybody has any ideas about how to do it because it becomes very, very hard to subtract out backgrounds of things. So it's not that we'll ever know more than down to the level of 0.0001. And it would be great if we see gravitational waves in that range, but it's also okay for inflation if we don't.
Okay, so what kind of inflation is that? Suppose we don't see a signal.
It's inflation that happens at very low energies, where the potential energy function for this field that drives inflation has a hill, where even the top of the hill has relatively low energy.
This is a question. Okay, so
the person at the back, please. So keep pushing into the lane to handle the microphone. So thank you very much for the valuable presentation. I have a simple question. So is the universe transitory or is it repeatable, recurring, cyclic cosmos or universe? Which one is that? Ours is a part of a universe cycle instead of a standalone single one-off universe, which is correct. You have mentioned about the endless inflation. So if that is the case, then just the other day I heard from Professor Murayama's presentation, there is a theory of a big rip, the end of the universe, that the universe will get ripped and get disappeared in the end. If that is the case, then something like a big crunch could happen as well. Then cyclic universe theory will hold. Any thoughts on this, anything?
Question. And the question involves something we're very uncertain about, so there is no definitive answer, I don't think, to the questions you're raising. But you're asking about what is the ultimate scheme of the multiverse. The simplest version of eternal inflation that I spoke about would lead not to genuinely cyclic universes, but to an infinite succession of universes. So in standard eternal inflation, one would have an inflating backbone of space growing exponentially, and at random locations in space and time, big bangs would occur, and local pocket universes would form. And the pocket universes would go on forming forever, so time will never end. There will always be living beings enjoying themselves throughout all time, the future of now. But it's not actually cyclic in terms of the universe getting big, getting smaller, getting big again. Now, there are other theorists who talk about exactly that theory, the theory that there's potentially one universe, it gets big, gets smaller, gets big again. I guess both Reinhardt and Seurat together have a model like that, and Penrose has a different model like that. And those certainly are outside possibilities. From my point of view, they're much, much less motivated than inflation, but much less biased, I probably am. And then, you also have the big rifts. The big rift is certainly a possibility. There certainly are kinds of physics that would cause regions of space-time to potentially disintegrate. And similarly, there are kinds of physics that would cause regions of space-time to collapse to singularities. I have to admit that I would say that we're very uncertain about what the aftermath would be about for either of those scenarios. We don't really understand how to think about space-time quantum mechanically. So these descriptions of big rifts or collapse to singularity are all really based on the language of classical general relativity. And classical general relativity allows these singularities, allows space to just end. On the other hand, quantum theory, as we know it, doesn't actually allow anything to end. Quantum theory is built in at the very ground level, is what's called unitary evolution, which really means that things just continue and continue, and everything's reversible. And anytime you know what state is, you can, in principle, have it backwards, according to what state was earlier. So that's inconsistent with the idea of space securing at these singularities. And since we don't have a viable amalgamation, valuable union between classical general relativity and quantum theory, I think we really don't know how things are going to play out, whether these singularities really mean the end of space, or whether something happens to space to resume.
Maybe one more question we can entertain from the floor. Please.
I could ask you this privately, but there might be general interest in the question. And the question is that the universe is now accelerating in its expansion. So imagine that we are a billion or 2 billion, or how many? The sun has not yet died out, and we're still around somehow, far enough in the future. If you look up in the sky, having the expansion, things will have disappeared. You may look up and see essentially a black sky. If we got to that point in time, and you were around, what would you be thinking about the universe you would then observe? Because it would seem to you, at that point, empty, or close to empty. So how do you reconcile the observer? Right? And you talked about an anthropomorphic principle. So if I'm out there, and I'm looking at the sky, and I see very little, and I'm trying to derive laws of physics, what laws of physics would I derive?
Okay, so it's an interesting question. If we were living 50 billion years in the future or something like that, the sky would look very empty if the acceleration that we're seeing now was just as expected to. That would not contradict anything that we now think. That is, you know, a real part of the theory that we're now proposing. So the theory that we're now proposing would still be quite viable. But it would also be harder to develop it because there'd be much less evidence. You'd hardly be able to see anything. Cosmic background radiation also gets weaker as the universe expands, so measurements of the cosmic background radiation would become harder and harder. And so what would I say? What physics might be like then, or even if it can exist then? So I don't know. I think I wouldn't go ahead and speculate. Certainly sure that physics would become a lot harder, or cosmology would become a lot harder if we were living 50 billion years from now. But still probably not possible. There would be traces. And even how amazing people have gotten to see their abilities to detect very low levels of cosmic background radiation, it must be possible to see the CMD and ultimately get graphs like the one I showed. But it would take a higher level of technology, but 50 billion years from now, people might have that technology.
Although it's unfortunate time has come, thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Booth. It has been 3 hours and a little more with the Chapley Foundation and Region Academy professor, ever since the professor Booth gave lecture on basic science, it was a good opportunity to raise awareness of basic science achievements, and we are thankful that the laureates came to Japan to give lectures. This is a biennial prize is awarded biennially, and 2 years from now, we may be able to hold another lecture session in Japan. Organizing such an event is not easy. Since the end of last year, we have been planning and preparing, and many people were involved in the arrangements for this event. And over a long time, in the planning, those who were involved, I'd like to ask them to stand up and be acknowledged. Instead of the Norwegian Embassy, it's Ben Guadon, and Yoko Nagatsuka, and from Kabuki Foundation, Nadine Sun. And from IGMA, Yuko Enomoto, who may be working somewhere. So this is not easy, but we are very grateful that we are finally able to have had this lecture session today. It's happy that the event comes to an end, so thank you very much. Thank you very much. Lion Dance Association, Arigato Lion, gives performance of Edo Isato Kakura and is active in Japan and abroad. He gives performance at New Year's events and wedding ceremonies and has performed in London in 2009 and he also gives performance at welcome ceremonies of state guests. And this is a traditional performance and fortune will come if a lion bite your head. So please have your head bitten by lions.